Joseph and Mary, who was great with child, were in Bethlehem to register for a Roman census, the time came for the baby to be born. Mary gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger. There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." And suddenly a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men on whom his favor rests." Wilmer McLean wanted to enjoy peace on earth in his humble town near Manassas, Virginia. Now, if you know who Wilmer McLean is, or if you're a Civil War buff, then you probably know that his peace was shattered when he got caught right in the middle of the first major battle of the Civil War, or as the Southerners call it, the War of Northern Aggression. Although his home was severely damaged at what is called First Manassas, or First Bull Run, he was able to rebuild it, only to have it destroyed 11 months later in Second Manassas. And that was too much fighting for Wilmer, so to escape the ravages of war, he moved to a different obscure community in Virginia called Appomattox Courthouse, which you probably know 3 years later was the site of one of the last battles of that war. And McLean's house was used by Generals Grant and Lee to sign the surrender agreement. But Wilmer McLean still didn't enjoy peace because the general's aides were so enamored or so moved by that experience that they wanted a memento, so they walked away with most of his furniture and household belongings. Wilmer McLean did not experience peace among men. Has anyone ever experienced, really, peace among men? No war, no fighting, no conflict, no meanness, no hatred. Something seems incongruent. Four times Jesus told men to go in peace. Four times he said to people, "Peace be with you." And one time he said, "My peace I leave with you." Where is this peace? It's definitely not in the halls of Congress. It's not in the media. It's not in the entertainment industry. It's not in sports. It's not in our jobs. For many, it's not even in our homes. "I bring you good news of great joy, and on earth peace among men." Really? Yes, really. Jesus came to bring peace, the failure of men not to achieve it notwithstanding. When God created us with free will, he risked the possibility, and I would add the probability, that men will choose hate over love, conflict over harmony, fighting over peace. And God knew it would happen that way. And so his plan from the very beginning was that he would send his son to bring peace to whoever would choose him. In what we call the Last Supper, Jesus did more than establish the communion service and as an element of worship. In a lengthy discourse to prepare his disciples for his death and ascension to the Father, he made some comments about peace. He said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled and do not be afraid." And then moments later, he spoke again about peace. "A time is coming," he said, "and has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home. You will leave me all alone, yet I am not alone, for my Father is with me. I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Now hear him. Did you catch it? He said, right now, you're not enjoying peace, the peace I came to bring. And it's going to get worse. But don't be afraid. The world is filled with trouble. Now, the word trouble, I've preached about this word before. The word is thlipsis. Thlipsis encompasses every possible kind of conflict, fighting, war, hatred, animosity, persecution, and sometimes just plain trouble wraps it all up. And he said, not only might we have trouble, he said, we will have trouble. People will hurt each other. Politicians will spew vitriol. Special interest groups will say evil things about whoever doesn't get on board with their agendas. Husbands and wives will fight and even abuse one another. And on we could go with the list. But that's not the end of the matter. Jesus said, trust me, have confidence in me, because in me you will have peace. So let's talk about that peace. It's obviously not freedom from conflict, for conflict continues. It is not living trouble-free, for trouble continues. It's not the absence of hating and fighting and meanness and animosity, for they all continue. I think the peace of which he spoke is a peace in which our hearts are okay, no matter what the circumstances, because we know God's got it. It's a peace in which I'm not afraid, because I know Jesus is Lord of life and death. It's different than the world's peace. The world's peace is based on favorable circumstances. When everything's going my way, I'm at peace. When things are not going my way, or if they're going badly, I am clearly disturbed and sad or angry. But the peace Jesus promises comes in spite of those circumstances. It's what Paul called the peace of God, which transcends all understanding. We don't always know and understand why we can be at peace in a world of conflict. The world certainly doesn't understand, but nonetheless, we are at peace. He went on to say that this peace will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is the peace of which Isaiah wrote, you will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast, because he trusts in you. See, not because all is well in the world, but because he trusts in you, he will keep you in peace. This is the peace which helps you to fight or face life's most difficult times without being changed. Your life in Christ remains steady, undistracted. The Bible says, great peace have they who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. Let's talk about that word stumble for just a minute. The word is mixal. Mixal refers to something like a rock that you might trip on if you're walking in the dark, or the coffee table you stub your toe on walking through the living room in the dark. But it also refers to an occasion that might cause you to act in a manner that violates your faith, perhaps striking out in anger or releasing a string of profanity. Mixal is that terrible experience that makes you sometimes think, my faith is invalid, something's wrong. Mixal was the occasion when Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were forced to decide either to worship God or to bow down to Nebuchadnezzar. These three men knew perfect peace. Threatened with a horrible death by burning, they were nonetheless at peace and said, if we are thrown into the burning or blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O King, we will not serve your gods. That is perfect peace. Great peace have they who love your law, and nothing can make them stumble. We're never promised that we won't be tested. We're promised that Jesus will be with us so that nothing can make us stumble or fall. Nothing can make us bow down. Nothing can make us turn away from Jesus. It doesn't mean we won't be scared or feel weak. It does mean that our troubles can't make us turn or give up, because we know who holds tomorrow and we know who holds our hands. A bit ago, I read Isaiah 26, verse 3, you will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast because he trusts in you. Let's read the two verses preceding, because there's just something wonderful in this song. In that day, this song will be sung in the land of Judah. We have a strong city. God makes salvation its walls and ramparts. Open the gates that the righteous nation may enter, the nation that keeps faith. The protective walls of the city are a metaphor for the safety and the peace of the salvation community. The righteous, those who believe God, may enter into that protection. In other words, we experience peace through faith in Jesus, and as the song points out, our faith in Jesus brings us into the community of salvation, and we find peace there, and that's, for what it's worth, that's the church. Now, I want to make this very practical, so please listen carefully. The people around you help shape your life. When you choose to believe Jesus, you become part of that salvation community. Now, we all know believers who turn from Salvation Community because they don't think they need the church. Well, they're giving away a major part of the protection and the support that God intended so that they can know perfect peace. When you're part of a church, there are other believers around you who model Christ for you and who can help you be accountable. And you gain strength when you know that others are watching you, and especially when you know some are depending on you. How many people here today work with people who use filthy language? Anybody? How many people today have people around you who are angry people? How many people here today have someone in your life who is of scatological mindset? In other words, they just have filthy minds. How many people have to deal with selfish, self-absorbed people? Now, here's the important question. Do you sometimes find yourself drifting into those behaviors? Maybe doing and saying things that you don't normally do and say. You certainly wouldn't do it here. For convenience, let's call these negative people. It's hard to not pick up the language and behavior of negative people when they are around you. We tend to become what our minds are trained on. And if we are surrounded by negative people, even if it's not our fault, we tend to start to pick up some of those behaviors. And when that happens, our peace gets messed up. Our peace can be messed up by the music we listen to, by the movies we watch, by the books and magazines we read. If you surround yourself with negative people, you're not going to find peace. The influence of negative people in entertainment is anger and blasphemy and cursing and lust and arrogance and impurity and self-righteousness and good old-fashioned debauchery. Because, as the Bible teaches, bad company corrupts good behavior. But you can still enjoy the peace that Jesus in the manger brought and that he promised. The Bible says, turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. In other words, we can do things to be at peace in the midst of all that trouble. I'm going to share two steps with you. The first one is very simple. Believe Jesus. Not didn't say believe in Jesus. I said believe Jesus. Faith is a choice. I encourage you to choose that you are going to believe that Jesus is who he says he is and that Jesus will do what he said he will do. Believe that Jesus' life and death is an historical fact. Believe that his resurrection is an historical fact, although many deny it. But don't stop there. Believe also that he came to seek and save lost souls. That's you and me. Believe that his death was a penalty for our sin, yours and mine. Believe that you can have the peace of which those angels sang and of which Jesus spoke. You can have peace, not based on circumstances, but in spite of circumstances. You know, one time a woman slipped into a dinner gathering where Jesus was attending. She came and sat at his feet, and she anointed his feet with oil, and she cried. She wiped his feet with her tears. And Jesus said to her, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Another time, there was a woman who had a medical issue where she was constant bleeding and she could not overcome that. And she thought one day as Jesus walked by, if she could just reach out and touch the hem of his garment, that she would be healed. And she touched his garment and Jesus sensed it. And he turned and looked to her and he said, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. What I want you to catch today is that both women found the peace they sought, but not because of their circumstances, because they believed Jesus. Their circumstances didn't change. That first woman to this day is branded as a prostitute. That's not a real positive way to mention someone. Her sullied reputation didn't change. The second woman was healed, but she was still penniless. Mark tells us that she spent everything she had on doctors who couldn't heal her. They chose to believe Jesus, and that faith brought them peace. Not their circumstances. They believed Jesus with all that that meant, and they found peace. You know, if you are a Christian and you don't know peace, you're doing something wrong. Now, maybe you believe the good parts about denying the heart, but you deny the hard parts. You know, the easy stuff about Jesus, you like that, but some of that stuff is tough, and you just don't go with that. Maybe you're believing the parts about salvation and love, but not the parts about persecution and suffering for his name's sake. Maybe you're believing the parts about comfort and joy, but you're thinking only of comfort and joy on earth, not the comfort and joy of eternity. One time Jesus said, "Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division." Now don't get carried away. That's not a contradiction. Jesus did come to bring peace, but it's the kind of peace in which we know that no matter what our circumstances, that God is with us and everything's going to be okay. The cross disrupts that peace, or disrupts our peace on earth, because it challenges us to make a choice of one or the other. You know, either we believe or we don't. And that's what Jesus was talking about here. I come to bring people to a point where you have to make a decision. And that's not peaceful until you get it right. And you know, not uncommonly, people who deny Jesus become critical of those who believe in him. And that creates more division, even in families. You see, either you believe Jesus or you don't. And if you choose to believe him, then believe everything and believe always. When you experience problems or ill health or persecution or seemingly unanswered prayer, don't doubt. Believe Jesus, even if you don't understand. You can still trust him. You don't have to doubt. Now, I hear people often say that when in the midst of trouble, said, "I'm beginning to lose my faith." And I say this in love, and I mean this. I'm not trying to hurt anyone. If circumstances cause you to quit believing Jesus, then your faith has a fault. And you need to work on that. Believe him always. We all would like everything in life to go our way. We would like every prayer answered with a great big fat yes. We would like every circumstance to be positive and beneficial for us. But it's not going to happen. Because it can only happen if God were to take away our free will. And that's not going to happen on earth. Because if he takes our free will away, then we will love him and we will believe him, but only because there is no other choice. And he wants us to love him because we choose to. He wants us to believe him because we choose to. And when we do, we know peace. That's a choice we make. That's step one. Step two is also very simple. Surround yourself with people and things that promote faith in Jesus. When Paul wrote that the peace of God transcends all understanding and guards our hearts, he immediately added, "Whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the peace of God will be with you." In other words, fill your mind with noble, pure, lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy things and people. Get involved in a church where you will be surrounded by people with whom you can admire and model after. You know, that's why we have very high standards for those who serve in leadership roles at Agape Christian Church, because people are watching. There's a lot we can learn from one another, what is good, what is right. And when we're living in the good and the right, we get tuned into Jesus. And when we get tuned into Jesus, we don't stumble. And nothing can make us fall because we know everything is okay no matter what. In the 1600s, Oliver Cromwell was a political and military leader in the Commonwealth of England. He tells of a time when he sent one of his officials to France to pursue a peace treaty, as he put it. And during the journey, the unnamed official was unable to sleep one night. He woke his servant that was sleeping in the room with him and told him, "I cannot sleep." Here's what he said, quote, "I am so afraid that something will go wrong with this diplomatic mission," close quote. And so the servant begged him if he could ask three questions, of which he was granted leave. And he said, first, "Master, did God rule the world before we were born?" And the man answered, "Yes, he did." And he said, "And will he rule the world after we are dead?" And the man said, "Certainly he will." And he said, "Then, Master, why not let him rule the present?" My friends, if you wish to know the peace of which the angels sang and which Jesus promised, then let him rule your life in the present. Believe him always and in everything, and surround yourself with people who will encourage and strengthen your faith by word and deed. Because in that, you will know peace among men on earth. And one day, you will go to the Father, into his house, where Jesus is. Let me pray. Father in heaven, your word is a powerful force. You have made some wonderful promises, and sometimes we have a hard time believing you. Help us to believe. Help us by being surrounded by other believers so that we will never fall. Nothing can take us away from you. I thank you that we have this opportunity in you, because your son was born and he lived and died and rose.